Hey everyone, how are you doing? You have Mike here, and today what we're going to do is cover the second part of our TNB Naturals test. So before we get into the data, because we have a lot of data to cover, you guys are gonna see how we did this. I think we did it in a pretty well way, with basically just tons of data and tons of different charts and the way we broke it down. So I think you guys are gonna enjoy that. But what I wanted to cover first is just a quick idea of what we're doing with our experiment. We're looking for how long the canister will last, and to do that we're going to measure till it gets down to our ambient CO2 level. We're going to test how much CO2 it produces, and that's kind of a hard one to do, but we're just going to do it in a way. We're going to open up our tent every day and we're going to let the CO2 equalize, and we're going to find out how much it brings it up. So that'll kind of give us a little bit of an idea. And we're also going to check out the decay over time. So we want to see how it basically goes down on a curve. It is going to go down on the curve. We just want to see how fast it decays. And that'll give us kind of an idea of also how long it's going to last from the decay. So, how do we do our experiment? We used a Perfect Prime CO2 gas meter. This meter here came in really handy. It has a data logger, so it allowed us to pull all kinds of data, which we were able to put in a spreadsheet, and then just, like I said, go from there and come up with a whole bunch of different charts and graphics for you guys. So how we did that was every day, like I said, we opened up our tent, we had let our tent equalize, we had given the bottle a shake, and we had put it back in the tent. So we did that every day throughout the test. So I did want to point out that there's kind of a difference between how we do testing and how a lot of other people do testing, especially manufacturers. Manufacturers, when they're testing, they're looking for optimum conditions. We are looking for real world conditions. So I have scoured the internet looking for TNB Naturals videos. There is a lot of them, and I've seen a lot of people using them in grow tents. They're using them in the exact same way that we did our test here. They closed all of their vents, their tops and bottom vents, their round vents, everything closed. I didn't really see anybody taping the vents shut to really make it totally airtight. But then again, zippers are airtight, and yeah, it's pretty hard to keep an airtight experiment, an airtight tent, unless you're in a plastic room that's all taped up and everything. But realistically, that's not how it's going to work anyway. You know, you guys have to go in your tent to water. You have to go in your tent. I know a lot of people, you just like going in your tent just to look. And I'm not knocking you, because I do that too. But there's a whole bunch of different things. You know, you got to water your plants, and you got to go in and inspect your plants, make sure everything's going right. So realistically, we're not going to shut our tent for 14 days and leave it. So we're doing realistic testing. That's why I open the tent every day, because when you open up a tent, you're letting out your CO2 anyway, right? So I think it's fair that we kind of open it every day, because you have to go in and shake it. So if you're doing this in a 12 by 12 room, you're probably going to have to open your door, go in and shake your bottle that's probably in the middle of your room over top of your plants, right? So that is why I open a tent every day. So like I was saying, companies that are testing their product, they're usually doing it in optimum conditions. So for instance, for this test here, I don't know, I can't speak for the company. I did ask, but I didn't get a straight answer how the test was done. But it's kind of, to me, seems like they did this in a very sealed room to get it 14 days. It was probably a sealed room, and I don't even think that they actually went in and shook the bottle every day. I think that would prolong how long the product works if you didn't shake it. So that's probably what they did. I'm not saying that's bad or wrong or anything, because that's just how companies test products. Look for instance, grow lighting. They always use this in a super reflective sidewalls to kind of raise up the light's ability. And we don't test like that here. We test on an open floor where we can see the actual spread of just the light, because we're looking for, once again, real world testing. So anyway, guys, let's get into the data, because there's tons of data to go through, and we'll go from there. Okay, so before we take a look at the data, I would like everyone to remember that the size of this experiment is much smaller than the recommended size on the bottle. Now, the bottle says it's good for a 12 by 12 by 12 foot area. We're using a 4 by 2 foot by 60 inch tall area. So there is quite the size difference between these two parameters. So keep that in mind. Now, we ran our test for 7 days. So I wasn't able to get any more data beyond day 7, just because it was lower than our ambient CO2, or equal to. So just unable to get reading at that point. So all this data here, we got our high readings, we got our low readings, and we got our ambient CO2. And then I got all 7 days and in one column, and then I've got a breakdown from 0 to 24 hours, first day, second day, third day, fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh, and it gives us all of our data. Now this looks pretty boring just looking at pure numbers, so I tried to make it a little bit more visual for you guys, so I made some charts, and we're going to take a look at those here now. So here is our ambient CO2. As you can see, day one, guys, 669, day two, 688, 811, day three, day four, 713, five, six, so forth. Just so you can get an idea of what our ambient CO2 level, that was done by pulling it out of our tent every day and getting that reading. So here's a different way to look at it. Here we have our highs. So as you can see, our high and our low, there's not much of a difference there. Day two, there was quite a bit of a gap. Day three, less. Day four, a little bit less. Then day five, it really kind of dropped off between our high point and our low point. And then our last point here, still a fall as well. So this does give us an idea of how much it is falling. So I'd only imagine that it is falling a lot more every couple of days. So one thing that we're able to mark is our point from here to here. So how high did it actually bring it up? So each day, day one, it raised it by 1,800 and 19 parts per million. Day two, 1,754. Day three, obviously 1,117. Day four, 912. We can kind of see how much it jumps. And then from about day five to six, really kind of cut back quite a bit. It wasn't able to raise our tenths part per million that high at all coming day six and day seven. So here's a closer look at it by day. You can see the first day here was a little bit, it took actually about a good 10 hours, I think about hour 10 before the product really started to pick up. Maybe that's because I didn't shake it well enough, but it definitely looks on day two that as soon as we shook it, it came up a nice curve, and then the curve slowly dropped. Day three, exact same thing. Day four, so I kind of believe that this is just, maybe it just takes the first 10 hours for it to really start kicking. I don't know. I'm not sure. But day five, and I also should point out on the sides here, 2,500 parts per million, 1,800 parts per million. So it is dropping quite a bit. 1,600 parts per million. And then day six went all the way down to 1,000 parts per million when it's peaking. It kind of just hovered near that. Day seven, I imagine, was going to do the same thing, but once again, I wasn't able to get any readings because it was already at our ambient CO2 level. So here is some more data for all 7 days. As you can see, we had our spike, it came down, same with this one, same this one, and then you can see it was really kind of erratic here on day five, six, kind of erratic, not much going on, it's pretty low, pretty much down at ambient levels. And day seven, as soon as I seen it go back down to ambient levels again, it wasn't really producing it enough for us to be worthwhile using. So really, guys, if you were not to open up your door and stuff to make an optimum testing, I'm pretty sure that it would have lasted maybe a couple more days. But you can still see how much it's actually putting out if you just keep looking. Every day it is producing a little bit less and down below. And I actually did take a picture at day 13 with my meter directly on top of the bottle. And it wasn't even producing the 1,400 parts per million. So I'm really not sure how that experiment, which I was saying earlier, was played out. Just because I'm not able to replicate that here with my bottle. This product, if you had a sealed tent, would obviously work for a day or two longer. But that's where we stand, guys. So this is my opinion on it. This is my results. I haven't seen anyone else that's actually tested it like this and showed all their data. And I'm going to make this data available for all you guys. You can actually just come down onto the description and you're going to see that there's a link to a drive. And that's going to have all of these individual documents on it where you can take a look at my data. I think from there, I'd like to thank everybody for watching. If you want to see more videos like this, please feel free to let me know in the comments. You have any questions, anything, just throw it down in the comments. Be happy to chat with y'all. So I would like to thank everybody for watching. I hope you did enjoy this video, and have yourself a great day. Take care.